Welcome to worship at Ryerson. Today, the element of fire, worship, come. Please gather in.
And just as another word of worship pragmatics, if you will, your church council has encouraged me unambiguously to begin worship right at 10 o'clock or maybe even a minute before. So those of you who have gathered today, hold that in mind and heart, and perhaps share that with others who you think or even know will be coming along to worship Sunday by Sunday at 10 o'clock. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
So again, welcome this morning, and we again remind ourselves of our elements of creation, and we begin this morning with our enacting of our elements. Earth, the seed of God, become the bread of God, the body of Christ for us all. Water, the water of life for us all, the water of baptism for cleansing and renewing. The breath of God, the breath of life that we all share, and the birth of the church, love which surrounds and invites us all in. And this morning, our last element to consider, the element of fire, that of worship. Let us enact our elements together. Rooted in earth, breathing wind, flowing as water, warmed as fire, sharing in love, take us as part of all creation to manifest you, our God, Creator, Redeemer, Sustainer, God in Trinity. Amen. So in Ryerson Reminders this morning, the first overall one is an invitation, an encouragement to be sure and read through your Ryerson Reminders as it comes across your inbox. And to emphasize this morning, again, your council has made a motion working out a previous motion of revisiting our mission statement. And that next motion calls on our committees to work out the implications specifically of demographic inclusion into our being an inclusive faith, Christian faith community. And a key part of that is our sign-up sheet for Sunday school care. Chicken or egg, no children, why bother signing up? No one signs up, a young person comes in, you can guess what the visual impact is. The sheet is there for you to consider. The request is, the hope is that there be one person for each Sunday, and even if that meant in every other month rotation, there for you to consider. And also on Ryerson Reminders this morning, an invitation to begin thinking about our trivia social coming up down the road. And now I would like Phil to come forward and offer some continued outreach invitations.
Good morning. I'll be in the fireside room today taking your donations for Canadian Food Grains. I have to tell you that Food Grains are a member of the Gaza Humanitarian Coalition, trying to get food into Gaza. So they're a worldwide organization, and they, just to give you a bit of information, they supplied food to 939,000 people in 34 countries from April 2021 to March 2022. And so they're a good organization to belong to, and we hope to continue to support them. Thank you.
Thank you, Phil. As we continue in worship this morning in this space, let us bring to mind the wider space in which we gather to worship and live in our acknowledgement of Indigenous lands. Ryerson United Church affirms that the land on which we gather is the traditional territory of the Haudenosaunee and Anishinaabe, is covered by the Upper Canada Treaties, and is within the lands protected by the Dish with One Spoon Wampum Agreement. We are thankful for the enduring presence of Indigenous peoples on this land. The God who calls us to rise and gather is the God who calls us to worship in spirit and in truth with all creation this Sunday. So, having heard that call, having heard that invitation, having gathered, let us continue to worship as we pray together our opening prayer for Creation Sundays. Let us pray. Creating God, help us to grow as trees do, stretching ever upward, arms and hands and hearts open to the world around us, by your grace, ready to let go of what we no longer need to carry. In the name of Christ, giver of every good and perfect gift, and Lord of creation. Amen. The gospel for this and every Sunday and every day is that in Christ, all who come to him will be made whole and be agents of bringing wholeness to our lives, and community, and all creation. This is our Lord's word of assurance this day. And so, may this peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Our opening hymn, On Pentecost They Gathered. And I would encourage you in the singing of this hymn to have an intentionality about the lyrics. They do underscore and help to amplify our overall theme of fire and worship this day. On Pentecost, they gather.
Thank you.
be pleased by your Spirit to speak to us through your written word, pointing us to and binding us to your living word, Jesus Christ. We invite Bob Penny to share the first two scripture readings.
Morning. Our first reading is coming from Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 to 8. Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian, and he led his flock beyond the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of a bush. He looked, and the bush was blazing, yet it was not consumed. Then Moses said, "I must turn aside and look at this great sight and see why the bush is not burned up." When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see God called him out of the bush, "Moses, Moses." And he said, "Here I am." Then he said, "Come no closer. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground." He said further, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, "I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on account of their taskmasters. Indeed, I know their suffering, and I have come down to deliver them from the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the country of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, Hivites, and the Jebusites." The second reading is taken from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 1 to 8. When the day of the Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from the heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under the heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound of the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one of them speaking in a native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language?" Let's end at the end of the word.
Thank you for the sharing of those scriptures. Our third reading comes from the book of Leviticus, chapter 6. "And the priest shall put on his linen garment, and his linen breeches shall he put upon his flesh, and take up the ashes which the fire has consumed, with the burnt offering and the altar, and he shall put them beside the altar. And he shall put off his garments and put on other garments, and carry forth the ashes without the camp unto a clean place. And the fire upon the altar shall be burning in it, it shall not be put out. And the priest shall burn wood on it every morning, and lay the burnt offering in order upon it. And he shall burn thereon the fat of the peace offerings. The fire shall ever be burning on the altar. It shall never go out. These are the scripture readings. Thanks be to God for his word to us. And now may the words of my mouth, the meditations of all of our hearts, and our intentions of will and spirit be acceptable and bear fruit in your sight. O Lord our God, we pray. Amen. Well, we have come this morning to the last Sunday in our Creation Sundays, with pauses along the way for Thanksgiving and our anniversary celebration. Creation Sundays has one of its underlying and overarching themes of an openness to insight and helpfulness from other spiritual traditions, especially here at Ryerson, indigenous spiritual traditions, and these insights to get us started to light our flame of reflection this morning, these offerings from what fire means in Aboriginal or Indigenous traditions. Fire is understood to be at the center of the circle, the medicine wheel, at all prayer ceremonies. Smoke carries prayers skyward. Fire protocol is a responsibility of men who are pure to be fire keepers. Fire is used for all ceremony and sweat lodge heats. A sacred fire is kept 4 to 10 days at the death of a member of the community. Fire produces our spiritual connection with Creator. And also this morning, I felt it good to share this reflection again from John O'Donohue in his book, The Four Elements. And if you're thinking, oh boy, not John O'Donohue again, well, he is one of my go-tos on this intersection between spirit and creation. I recommend, pretty obviously, reading of anything by John O'Donohue. So, in my anticipated last sharing of his thoughts on fire, a bit of a longer one, a bit of a longer story. Oh, I should preface it by saying, a friend of mine recommended John O'Donohue. His book called Beauty, picked that up, enjoyed it, and then he lay rest. And then, about 15 years later, sort of a pilgrimage, because Ireland and Celtic spirituality is kind of a place of pilgrimage for me. I am in Ireland with my family. My two daughters are teaching for 2 years in England. So we thought, let's treat to a family trip. So we went to Dublin, then to Galway. The point of that story? It turns out, at our Airbnb in Galway, our hostess knew John O'Donohue during the period when he was a priest, and in fact, he baptized our hostess's children, which underlined for me then and now the relevance, the importance, it's a good thing to share some John O'Donohue this morning. Here he is, writing in his chapter about fire. I would try this in an Irish lilt, but it would be maybe 50 to 60% successful at best, so I'll not bother. In country houses, the fires were smoured on each night. This seals them from the searing of the air. Smoor is a lovely word. Its sound captures exactly the powdered smother of ashes that quenches and slows the desire of the coals to go up in flames, yet holds them alive and kindled. In some houses, this fire was literally never put out. I'm hoping that rings some bells this morning. The same fire lasted from generation to generation. It is a beautiful image of the warmth of a family continuing over generations. Around that fire, most of the sacred and turbulent life of the family took place. As each person has a different spirit, so too each home has a unique spirit. The Celtic tradition has a fine sense of the sacredness of the hearth and fire and its place in our spiritual life. Well, thank you, Indigenous Teachings and John O'Donohue. And we come now to our five elements, and this morning, that of fire. So people often say to me, I've heard it over the years, that parishioners, people in congregations, you folks here this morning and those who are watching online, like to hear some stories about the minister or priest or whatever, my own spiritual journey and experience with the scriptures or what I'm talking about on any particular day. So if you're thinking that's a bit of a warning, you're right. I've got a number of fire, more specifically, worship stories to share with you this morning. So here is the first one. The image before, if Rick can bring it up. There you go, that's the one. So this is Delta United Church, East End of Hamilton. Picture this. I'm in a family that isn't typically a church-going family in the 1960s, which is in itself not typical, but nevertheless, that's the truth of it. We would occasionally go off to church, and this particular time was a Christmas time, typical, I think, of churches who are people who are curious, but nevertheless not committed. Anyways, we go off to Delta United Church, and I'm pretty young, probably about 7 or 8, I believe. And so we're in the church, and we're sitting in the balcony. There we go. So we're sitting in the balcony. Worship has begun. The invitation came to go down to Sunday school. And I can remember, as clearly as I'm standing here, very deliberately thinking and having the nerve to say, I don't want to go to Sunday school. I'm feeling God here in the balcony in worship. Now, that's not to say that I was some kind of spiritual ahead of this time, but rather to point to that what I would call innate, God-given sense of sacredness, of worship, and how churches, like those generational fires in the story from John O'Donohue, carry with it a generational memory of the sacred, of worship, being awesome in its old and in its new sense. This drawing into God that I felt as a young person later became involved and developed in different ways. But that child with that sense of God in that worship place continues today, as do all of our children and grandchildren. So from that experience, fast forward a decade or two or three, and another church. This time I'm in this journey of sharing worship, sharing this morning, carried that memory from a Delta United, wasn't really acted on. Then at the end of another Delta Secondary School, and my final year, through the kindly guidance of my music teacher, Murray Black, and some other friends in my class, We had gathered, and I remember this very clearly as well, we had gathered close to the end of our final year, and we were having a party, and then we were sitting outside, and while outside we were struck by the huge number of stars that night, stars which will come into our Ryerson worship down the road a bit. Nevertheless, for the sake of the story, there we were, and it wasn't me who started this conversation, but someone led in as we were acknowledging and enjoying the stars. Someone led in with the question, well, what about all of you? Do you believe in God? Some said yes, some said no, and a conversation ensued. Eventually, the yeas won it, and I don't know why this happened, but somehow, and again, it wasn't me who suggested this, although maybe I wish I had, we moved from that gathering in that backyard on Garside Avenue with a mission to go to Holy Family Roman Catholic Church and see if anyone would open the door at 10 o'clock at night and lead us into a place of worship. Of course, we're kids, kind of nutty and kind of nervy to imagine that, but off we walked the 5 or 6 blocks. Church was in darkness. One of our member, who I guess was Roman Catholic, said, well, the priest's house might be around the corner in the same building. So, emboldened by our nerve so far, we go around the corner, we knock on the vestry, not a separate house. A priest comes and answers the door. I guess we kind of lucked out with this particular father's perspective and compassion and insight. And so he welcomed us, didn't seem to be too distraught about what we were doing there as a bit of a group at 10 o'clock. And someone explained, we'd had a conversation. We gazed up at the stars. We decided God is there for us. Can you lead us to a place of prayer in that vein? So he led us in to the Holy Family Sanctuary. It's a lot darker than this. Threw a couple lights on and said a prayer over us and over our faith. All of that to point to that first scripture in Exodus. Take off your sandals. The place that you are residing is holy ground. The holy ground. The holy ground of worship. All of us, for our children and grandchildren, and for myself at Delta United and Delta Secondary, and us here at Ryerson. So our next scripture, and a few more decades on, another story, kind of a two-part story. So by this time, I had acted on that faith, gone to seminary, was engaged as associate minister at Knox Presbyterian Church in Dundas, and they had decided for their mission to be generationally, demographically inclusive, they needed to have another expression of worship. And the senior pastor at that time suggested that Ginghamsburg in Ohio, Ginghamsburg United Methodist Church, would be a good example for Knox Presbyterian to consider. So as the staff person charged with looking at that and moving that expression of worship forward, I kept that in mind. We're on a road trip to Florida. It is in fact a stormy Christmas Eve. We probably shouldn't have been driving. For whatever reason, I had in mind that this Ginghamsburg United Methodist Church was in Vermont. But we're driving down the I-75 in a snowstorm, and then, in my memory, erupting out of the darkness, darkness, or looming out of the darkness, is a sign for Ginghamsburg. So I make mental note. By now, putting the snowstorm aside, we haven't really traveled that long, so I thought, if this is to be the model, if this is where our church is at, I'm going to make it a point to return here someday and see what it's all about. This is long enough ago that there wasn't that much internet information. Nevertheless, so I kept that in mind. So then I'm at another church. And that church is funded by Presbytery to make a mission trip to Ginghamsburg United Methodist Church in Ohio. We all bore our wounds and our sorrows and our challenges. So this is what Ginghamsburg Church looked like when the pastor of the church arrived there. A little frame country church, Ginghamsburg United Methodist Church. His name was Mike Slaughter. And it was shared that his mission, it was stated, I don't know if it was stated to the people at the church, but it was stated to him by the United Methodist bishop who sent him there. He said, your mission is to go to this church and be sure that you close it without too much pain or sorrow. Well, unfortunately, or fortunately, I think more fortunately, Mike Slaughter pretty much ignored the directions and decided to see how this little church, what might happen if it was to engage in mission and care and inclusion. So that's what he did. And here's what the church looked like after about 10 or 15 years. Kind of looks like campus, called what is outdated language even now, a megachurch. But not for its own sake, it grew with the work of the Spirit, with legitimate and involved and inclusive worship. And so our little troop arrived from Ontario. We go into the sanctuary, and into the sanctuary, all of us feeling a little bit tentative, we sit down, and we hear in the sanctuary a, at that time, current song by Natalie Imbruglia called Torn, which sounds like this. So imagine, if you can, you're in this group, in worship, and the band starts up with the playing of this popular rock song. But not accidentally, not gimmickly, rather to carry the message of that day, which is how we are all torn, but Christ is the healer. Our second scripture comes to us from the book of Acts, the birth of the church at Pentecost. Pentecost, which was one of the main celebrations of the Jewish people, which celebrated new birth and new life. And you can well imagine that that group of disciples read for us in Acts, like this little group from Ontario in Ohio, like all of us, wherever we are this morning, were and indeed are torn. And into that gathering, the upper room, it's called, it is said, it is recorded, it is lived out through generations, and this very day that the Spirit was given as people worshiped in tongues of flame and in wind of fire. You may have picked up on that various languages were spoken, and the Pentecost miracle, if you will, that each could understand the other as if they were speaking their own language. And I think the real miracle of that speaks to the place of worship, as it was in Pentecost, as it was in Ginghamsburg, as it can be and should be and is here at Ryerson, that worship not only heals and focuses, but draws us together in understanding and in love in Christ, who is the healer. So our worship journey thus far this morning, an overall sense of the awesomeness of God Creator, this particular experience of worship inclusion in the name and in the purposes of Jesus Christ, the Lord of life. And then the next scripture and worship experience. Our third scripture is probably not one that's common to us. In great detail, we heard from Leviticus of those specific instructions for the priest to wear certain garments, to deal carefully and specifically with the ashes. Jewish worship in the temple was no accidental or hurried affair. It was very intentional, and very deliberate, and very specific. Now, it may struck our worship ears and hearts and minds and experiences of foreign and perhaps a bit odd, and let's face it, when we read it, when we hear it, the burning of ashes, sacrifices, all of that is more than a little bit odd. At the heart of Leviticus's telling, at the heart of its message for us today, is God's repeated instructions to those careful priests to keep the fire on the altar burning, as it did in those Irish homes, as it did through decades and centuries and generations, from Delta United to Ginghamsburg to Ryerson. And then this third specific worship time, I bring to mind a worship time at Bethesda. It was a Christmas Eve. We had just entered into a change from purple of Advent to blue of Advent. It was early on in my time at Bethesda. We gathered in hopeful anticipation of celebrating the birth of Christ in this somber and quiet service. And what happened at that service is that the power went out. On Christmas Eve, just what you don't want to happen, with all the weight of expectation, with all the hopefulness of a few scattered visitors, power went out, but fire of worship remained. We carried on. We carried on in worship and in receiving Christ. And yes, we fast forward to the lighting of the Christmas Eve candles. You have to be pragmatic, after all. So those candles were lit. That Christmas Eve worship service stays with me and stayed with me and particularly stays with me as a living animal, at that call from Leviticus to keep fire of worship alive. Now, as that's resonating and ruminating in your minds and hearts, a cultural reference to wrap up this time. Not really much of a soccer person, despite being in England for a year and my kids being there for 2 years, but I'm starting to get an affinity, seeing as we have a home team by the name of Forge. If you don't know, they're in the Canadian Premier League. Here is their scarf, helpfully in orange, and they won the Canadian Premier League Championship in overtime last night. What's the name of this team? Forge. Taken from the fires of the forges of Stelco, which so inform and help to grow so many lives, some people employed or have been employed by that company here at Ryerson. But the point of the day, it was a reminder, that goal in overtime, that forging onward, that keeping the fire of faith burning brightly, burning strongly, burning courageously, burning inclusively for Ryerson in 2015 years and now beyond. Amen. Thanks be to God who calls us to gather together to continue to worship in spirit and in truth through the generations, through the calamities, through the realities, and the blessings of churches, families, and communities. Amen. Our hymn of response this morning, admittedly taken from that era of that worship at going to Holy Family Church, it only takes a spark. We stand in worship. Center of creation, the center of love, the ground of being, the heartbeat that seeks to resonate with our own hearts. We thank you for all roads into an acknowledgement and a being blessed by the sacredness, the stillness, and the sanctity of you, our God, as Creator. We thank you, God, that into the brokenness of creation and human lives and churches and political institutions and countries, into war and disease, into exclusion and apartheid and injustice, you came incarnate in Jesus Christ to take all of that, to enter into it, to hold it even on a cross and into death. And yet, by the power of the Trinity, by the wonder of the Trinity, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed, and so we thank you for our resurrection life, ongoing, still being worked out. Thank you for the church birthed at Pentecost, and we thank you for our spiritual ancestry, for those priests that followed your instructions, for that fire on the altar, for that fire of worship, sustained by the breath of your Spirit, in Ryerson, for these now 215 plus days and weeks and generations. With these things, we would add our intercession that your church and people would grow as you would have us to grow, that you would bless with peace and ways forward for those here today and known and loved by us, struggling with physical, spiritual, or emotional challenges, all part of the work that you are doing. Give them a touch of your Spirit and ways forward for our churches, for our church, and for all our nations. And to these intercessions, we would continue in prayer, in the prayer that Jesus gave to us, praying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Offertory. Thank you. responsive, sending prayer. We go from here, not as owners of the sunlit sky, but as those who share it with all creation. We go from here, not as owners of creation, but as those who live in a caring, respectful relationship with creation. We go from here to celebrate life's goodness and to work for a new world and a beautiful day that beckons in the promise of Christ, promise of love, and abundant life for all creatures and all creation. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the peace of the Holy Spirit be with you all, this day and always. Amen.
Thanks for coming along. God bless you and yours. We'll see you next time.